distributed. Okay, so he has two children.
Yeah.
L and W. And he gives an advancement to L for $10,000. And his estate is worth $20,000. Mm-hmm. I know there's kind of a funky way to calculate
You do the hodgepodge. Remember that? It's like where you pretend that he hadn't given it at all.
Right.
So how much would they get?
If... So L would get 10.
Yeah.
And W would get 10.
Yeah. No. Well, right. No. So you add like this 10 to the 20.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's
so it's like 10. So 10 plus 20.
Which is 30.
And then they each get 15. So L gets 5.
Oh, interesting.
And the other
guy. I don't remember this. It's so weird.
Yeah. It's funky, but
Guess you just have to practice.
Yeah. It's the hodgepodge rule.
That's something that I'm going to do like a list of things to do like the day of the exams that are fresh in my mind, and that's one of them.
Yeah, that'd be good. Let's try to plan tomorrow to try to meet him at the same time, because I don't think he feels as bad taking up the time of multiple people.
Okay.
If it's just one person, I don't know.
That's
Does
fine.
That make sense?
Yeah, that works fine.
Yeah. And thank you very much again for the Quizlet invitation.
Problem. I hope it helps.
Oh, yeah. It's a good source right there.
Okay, so there's 30,000, L gets 15, W gets 15, and then...
But L already got his 15.
10
yeah.
From L, so L gets 5.
Right. Let's see if there's another one.
Yeah, there are.
Oh, there are? Okay.
And W still keeps the 15. Okay.
Assume the probate.
Hotchpot rule. Okay, assume the probate estate was worth 100. It makes no sense for L to participate. And L does not have to participate because it's intestacy. So L basically gets to keep the 10,000, doesn't get counted against L. And the brother, W, just gets 100.
Oh, okay. That's kind of funny, but kind of depressing, I guess.
I would definitely remember that.
Okay.
You don't have to participate.
Okay. Assume that L predeceased Frank survived by two children, T and W. Recipient does not survive decedent.
Assume that L predeceased Frank survived by our two children, T and W. Bless you. D. Bless you. T and W. By L. Okay. Advancement is not considered in determining the division distribution to the heirs.
Nice.
Okay.
Okay.
That's cool.
That's good to know. I'm going to highlight that because that's kind of the rule right there. I'm going to do the pink highlight that you did.
Yeah.
Okay. I might print this out tonight.
77 pages worth of printing?
Might be worth it, right?
Totally up to you.
Okay.
I mean, if it were open book, I
guess I have like a tablet here. I could just scroll through it.
Yeah, I mean, if it were open book, I totally would, but. Okay, assume that Frank gave L property rather than cash. Would the answer change if the value of the property changes? Okay, I'm trying to remember. I think no.
Yeah, that's
change in value would not
appreciation. Depreciation.
10,000 amount stays because that was the value of the time of the gift. Gift of property is valued at either the time the heir came into possession or the time of deceased death. Disclaimers, renunciations.
So, yeah.
Disclaimer includes renunciation. I have no idea what that means.
So, I think renunciation is like, I don't want this anymore. Or...
Oh, you renounce.
Yeah.
Definition. A beneficiary of a will, trust, or insurance policy, or life arrangement, as well as a taker under intestacy, may decide to forego the offered bounty. I would love to memorize that and put that on my exam. An heir, will, beneficiary, blah, blah, blah. Or the survivorship agreement may disclaim or renounce the person's interest. So that's the definition for disclaimer?
Yeah. Remember in class he said you may not want to do this because, you know, there might be a gift tax or something like that.
No. What do you mean?
So... Somebody asked him, why would anyone, like, disclaim property? Like, any sort of, you know, I'm getting 1,000, you know, or 50 acres. Why would anybody? He said, for tax reasons.
Hmm.
Yeah, it's right here, too. Why would someone disclaim creditors' claims?
It says that you may wholly or partially disclaim. After disclaimer, property gets divided per stirrups. For stirpes? I don't know what that means.
Where are you looking? Notes?
This is in my flashcards.
Oh, okay.
If valid disclaimer, creditors cannot attach the interest. You can only disclaim after decedent's death. Very interesting.
Yep, definitely.
So disclaimer applies to testacy and intestacy.
Yeah, I think so.
Will, trust, yeah, beneficiary of a will, trust, insurance policy, and a taker under intestacy. So tomorrow I'm definitely going to go through a lot of these note cards. Okay. Good to know. Oh, requirement for disclaimer. It must be in writing, acknowledged by notary or an authorized person, filed in a probate court. Oh, you can't disclaim later than 9 months after the decedent's death. You cool with that?
Yeah. Yeah, I was just scrolling through these. But it wouldn't be too bad. I mean, you can just sort of relax, sit on the couch or something.
Totally.
The filing deadline. We probably don't really need to know this, but Requirements for disclaimer, in writing, acknowledge, and generally filed in court with probate jurisdiction.
I just said, in writing, acknowledge, by notary, other authorized person, following the probate court.
Okay. And then filing deadline, 9 months, basically.
Yeah. You can have partial disclaimer. The part that's accepted goes to the beneficiary. The part that's explained goes to the next in line. Disclaimer is irrevocable.
Nice.
Offer you subject to disclaimer. Only that share is treated as if the individual predeceased. You don't go back and redivide all the shares. Okay. Assignment is a get, not a disclaimer. I don't know. Get that.
Oh, that was one of my questions, actually. I'm going to look that up in the book.
Okay.
Oh, okay. Assignment's like contract assignment, where you assign a duty or something to somebody else.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Oh, I don't know.
No, so you know how you have...
Equitable conversion of title.
Oh, nice. So, the person,
yeah.
Remember, like, the property, everything was already signed. It's going to be sold, the property. So, basically, as an equitable doctrine, the courts, if a court will recognize that this contract for conveyance of property is going to go through, then the person gets legal title, like the heir gets legal title to the land, until it's fully transferred to the party that's buying the land. But they don't have, they just have legal title, they don't have use, or it's temporary legal title, as long as a court would recognize that that contract is getting sold. Let's see what's written here.
So sale of real property is treated as being final, even if not completed. And... it applies to when the decedent dies. Dies while the contract is pending. So kind of rare instances. It's just to protect his interest. And it only applies to real property. The sale of real property is treated as final. Even if it is not not yet completed. Even if the transaction.
Yeah.
Transaction is not yet complete. Applies when the student dies while pay is pending. Okay. Matters because one person might be entitled to real property and someone else might be entitled to personal property. Oh, okay. So this is basically like determining whether it's going to stay as real property or whether it's going to turn into like a cash asset, right?
Yeah, so he'll get the cash proceeds.
Yeah.
Or whoever the heir is.
So it's not like it'll cancel the contract that's going through. Like,
no.
Basically, if the decedent was trying to sell the property,
mm-hmm.
then, okay, let's say that I'm trying to sell a piece of property, I'm in a contract, negotiation for it, and then I die. When the property does sell, the money transfers into my estate. But let's
right.
say that I'm trying to buy property, and the contract is pending. Do you think that applies too?
We should ask him that.
Okay.
Yeah, we gotta ask him that. That's a really good question, actually.
Thank you.
No, that's total. That's very totally on. I like that. So it's like equitable conversion opposite, like the opposite of it in a way. Basically, we're.
Conversion of title.
Decedent was buying property.
Yeah. I mean, it's still a conversion of title, so. It can happen by contract or will. Aliens. A person is not disqualified as an heir if he or she is an alien.
Look at a different country. That's kind of a side note, really.
He or she is a person who claims to the person is not disqualified as an heir. It's an alien. Just that simple. Okay, passage of title. When a person dies by will or in testacy, property thus immediately upon decedent's death, subject only to payment of debts. Exceptions are disclaimer, determination of heirship, and contested wills. Do you want me to make a flashcard on that? Passage
sure, yeah. You just copy it in there, I guess.
Okay. Oh, posthumous heirs are heirs who are born after the intestate dies. Posthumous heirs, children, grandchildren will inherit. Posthumous non-lineal heirs will not inherit. What? False.
Okay, so this is like if you have a child or grandchild. So, like, let's say your wife has a baby and you pass away, right? That baby would probably still inherit, right?
Wait, can you repeat that, please?
So you're like the husband, and your wife has a baby. She's like 4 months pregnant.
Yes, yeah, so does this apply to people who are like babies in gestation?
I think so.
Because I have on the flashcard, posthumous heirs. Nephew is in gestation, nephew will take. An heir does not have to be born to inherit so long as in gestation.
Oh, that's interesting. We should ask him about that, posthumous heirs. Would nephews take if in gestation?
No, I think that's exactly what it is. Like it protects people who are coming into the world during the death, not people who will come into the world after the death by conception. But my flashcard is contradictory because Brent Dewar's outline says,
yeah,
posthumous nominal heirs.
Let's ask Alton about it.
Yeah. Yeah, we definitely need clarification on that. Because I think that in Alton's class, he said the nephew could inherit if he's in gestation, but that's contradictory to this outline. Presumption of paternity under the family code. 331 days.
That's like 3 months, right? Or 9 months. Three times.
How many days are there in a year?
365.
Oh.
So this is just, that's more than 9 months, 311 days.
I think it is.
Divided by.
Days in a year. That's basically like 11 months.
That's weird.
Well, I guess it's just in case it's an extra long pregnancy.
What?
Yeah, some babies don't want to get out.
Really?
Actually, I think that's roughly 9 minutes. That can't be.
No, that's no.
Yeah, it's 365 minus 339. 34 days of difference, so it's like 10 something months.
Yeah, so 9 months is 273 days.
Okay, so let's just say it's like 11 months.
That's weird.
Baby just doesn't want to get out.
Yeah.
Husband, wife are married, husband dies intestate. 4 months later, wife gives
birth. That makes sense.
X will X share in husband's estate. Yes! He falls within a 331 day presumption. Okay, so I'm going to make a flashcard, presumption of paternity. Baby must be born. Born 331 days after the father's death. Does this only apply to marriage? I think so.
Well, I mean, if he's the father, right, of the child.
Well, there's all different sorts of fathers. At law.
Right.
Let's see here. 160.204. I bet it just applies to marriage. A man is presumed to be the father of a child if he is married to the mother of the child and is born during marriage. He is married to the mother of the child, and the child is born before the 301st day after the date the marriage is terminated by death. Married.
Yeah, I guess just 331 is the rule, because I suppose you're right. In some cases, it could
take.
It says
301 here.
301?
Yeah, it says he is married to the mother of the child, and the child is born before the 301st day after the date the marriage is terminated by death.
That makes more sense.
Where that is in the book.
Hmm. Yeah, I didn't see presumption of paternity in the index in the back.
I guess I would get clarification from also on that, whether it's 301 or 331 days. And does that apply to, that's a test to see, right?
Right. Because a will would mention it.
Do you only inherit under intestacy, or do you inherit under testacy, under a will and intestacy?
I think you. Oh, that's a good question.
Inherit intestacy.
Or shouldn't it be in this thing right here?
It's towards the beginning of this outline. Let me look. Oh, you do not inherit through a will. You only inherit through intestate succession.
Okay.
So, what's the term for under a will? You take. You take.
Okay, that's good to know. Inheritance is for
Intestacy. Inherit intestacy. You take under a will. Because I guess it's considered the property is given to you at that person's request. Whereas inheritance comes from the laws of inheritance.
take under a will.
As a devisee
It's interesting.
or beneficiary.
I really need to go to the restroom.
Yeah,
I'll be
go.
back.
And here's quasi-community property, which we already covered.
Yeah.
Woohoo!
Alrighty. Quasi, and now we're at will execution.
Okay, yeah. So, the requirements for a valid will, you have to have perfect compliance with the statutory right. execution requirement. There is no substantial compliance will in Texas. Right. What is required for a will to be valid? Testamentary capacity.
18 years of liberty.
So you have to be of sound mind and 18 years or older, or a member of the armed forces, or is or has been married. So sound mind is a requirement, and then it's either 18 years of age, member of the armed forces, married or has been married. Okay, and then here are some examples of whether legal capacity is met. If you're married, it's a 17-year-old, yes. 17-year-old who's married and now divorced, yes. Unmarried 17 in the Army, yes. Unmarried 17 discharged from the Army, no. Because you're not currently in the Army. That's the trick.
Yeah, that's the tricky one right there.
Okay. Let's say that the guy entered the military at 17 years of age and made a will. He was discharged while he was still 17. May he change or revoke his will? If it's a valid will, he's in the military, he can't change or revoke it because he's not still in the Army, has to wait until he turns 18. But I guess it is a valid will, so it's valid. Because that person had testament or capacity at the time the will was made. That's what it is.
Mm-hmm.
But it can't be changed or revoked because now that that person is discharged, he doesn't meet any of the testament or capacity requirements to be able to amend the will until he turns 18. That's another little trick.
Nice. So, like, you were in the military, you came out, and you just...
I made a will while I was in the military.
Right.
And then I'm discharged.
You're 17 in like mm-hmm. 4 months. You can't revoke it. You can't do anything.
No, I just have a valid will.
Right. But if you were married when you were like 16 and you get divorced at 17.
It still counts.
It's still, you can still, okay.
Yeah. I think so.
Yeah, cool. Alrighty. Testamentary capacity?
Yeah. Yeah, it counts. At 16, doesn't count. Statutory age requirement in the United States Code prevents disability removal, allowing him to make a will. Okay, so being under 18 is considered a disability. And even if you get that disability removed, it still won't allow you to make a will. Okay. What does sound mind mean? Sufficient mental capacity to understand the business engaged in, understand the effect. Do you memorize all this stuff?
Yeah. So this is how I memorize it. Understand what you're doing. You're making a will, right?
Uh-huh.
Understand the effect of the will.
Okay.
Understand the extent of property. Understand what you have. And understand who you're giving it to.
Yeah,
and keep it all in his mind.
Next of kin and natural objects of his bounty.
Right.
Okay.
Next of kin, yeah. And, like, does he understand who he's going to give it to?
Okay.
So does that make sense?
I think so.
So tell them to, right?
Okay.
I want to help you.
You have to know the nature of the will itself. You have to know the effect of the will.
Yeah.
You have to know the kin, or I guess, is it the beneficiaries that you're
Yeah, who your beneficiaries are going to be.
And then what's the fourth one? Oh, no.
Who you're giving it to. Like, what are you giving? The property. The nature of your property.
The nature of the property.
Yeah.
The general nature and extent of the property.
And then keep them all in your mind together.
Jeez.
Yeah.
Okay, I definitely need to have a flashcard for that.
Yeah.
What is sufficient mental capacity? Okay. And then I can probably make it more succinct. So, understand business. understand business in which he was engaged. Well, can I just say understand act of making will?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the act of making, yeah, definitely.
Understand the effect. Understand the effect of making the will. Does he know that his will transfers title at death? 3, understand general nature and extent of property. Does it need to know the exact amount, general amount? Okay. 4, know next of kin. But I don't see why you have to know the next kin or natural object of your bounty, because you want to give everything to charity. Like,
I think, yeah, that can be like, you know who you're giving it to is how I interpreted it.
Okay. Okay, and then the relevant point in time for determining whether the testator had capacity was when will was made. Just yeah. Remember that, because he could like lose that later, but as long as he had it at the time the will was made, it's cool. May a person execute a valid will even though the person has been adjudicated as insane?
Yes.
Adjudicated insane does not necessarily mean unsound mind. The adjudication is prima facie evidence of unsound mind. Can be rebutted. May have a brief lucid interval that rebuts unsound mind. Same person may lack capacity to have a moment of belief. Okay. Contractual capacity versus testamentary capacity. I think that testamentary capacity is a lower standard than contractual capacity, which is interesting. Why is that? T is dead, making a contract will make you bear the consequences of your
right.
interest.
Testamentary capacity, T is dead.
Okay.
Lucid interval.
Stuff.
Yeah.
Mm.
Okay, client wants to make a will, but attorney can obviously tell him that client does not have capacity. Attorney may be under an ethical duty to seek appointment of a guardian for a client who's disabled when it is reasonably apparent that a guardian would be in the client's best interest. Attorney-client relationship may not be established. The individual is of unsound mind.
Okay, cool. Okay, I'm just going to skip down to testamentary intent. Testator must have testamentary intent in order for a document to consider the will. So what did we just discuss?
Testamentary intent.
No,
or no,
capacity.
Yeah, testamentary capacity.
Okay, so testamentary capacity versus intent.
So intent, I think it's like, I want to be making a will. And, yeah.
Excuse me. You must have the intent to create a revocable disposition of property to take effect after death. Okay. I'm going to write that down.
I'm going to highlight that, yeah. You can put that in the...
Yes.
You rock. That's what's up.
Oop, I've already got it in there.
Man, we are so lucky. We got this, and then, you know, got some nice technology on our side. Very cool.
Let's see here. So it is. Must have intent to create. No, don't do that. Must have intent to create a revocable. That's what we have to have memorized. Revocable disposition of property to take effect after death.
Right.
Okay. You must intend for the document to dispose of property at the time of death. You have testamentary intent even if you don't know that you're making the will. If it's executed under compulsion, undue influence, part of the ceremony for the purpose of deception, it's not a will. Will written on the back of the greeting card was held to be a holographic will. Argument against it was that it was just a letter. Regardless of how well a testamentary intent appears on the face of an instrument, extrinsic evidence is admissible to show lack of intent. The reverse is not true. If testamentary intent is lacking on the face of an instrument, you cannot introduce extrinsic evidence to establish testamentary intent. So it has to be clear on the face of the document.
Nice.
Put that in there. Testamentary intent must be clear on the face of the document. Extrinsic evidence not allowed to prove TI. Okay, formalities necessary for an attested will. Okay, so just remember that with holographic wills, you do not have to have a holographic will executed. So these formalities apply to a written, a typewritten will. Must be in writing, signed by the testator or a proxy for the testator who is either, no, I'm sorry, signed by the testator or a proxy for the testator who is both in the testator's presence and under the direction of the testator. Attested to by two or more credible witnesses. They must be over 14 years of age and subscribe their names in their own handwriting in the testator's presence. Okay.
So, in...
That's a lot.
So, signed by testator or proxy for testator in the testator's presence and attested by two or more credible witnesses.
Okay, let me read the last part on this. One. In writing. Two. Signed by testator. Four. Proxy for testator.
Nice. And then we're going to go into depth on all these. Like,
yes.
We're going to ask, yeah, that's what's later on.
We definitely need to have all this memorized.
Right, right.
Which is not crazy memorization type.
No,
two,
it's not.
We already know a lot of this. Two more credible witnesses.
Right.
Who must be at least 14 years of age. Over 14, I'm sorry, so 15 or older. I'm 14 years of age. So their names must be subscribed in their own handwriting.
Right.
In testator's presence.
Yeah, so signed by testator or through testator's proxy.
Mm-hmm.
Witnesses must also sign in the presence of testator.
Mm-hmm. And under his direction.
And under his direction. Very cool. This is some practical stuff right here, you know?
Oh, yeah. It's a great outline. Okay. Does it have to be written in a particular form? Okay. And he said that videotape would probably not be a will. No oral wills haven't been allowed since 2007. What's the technical term for an oral will?
Non-cupative.
Non-cupative?
Yeah.
Okay. Cool. Written includes any representation of words, letters, symbols, or figures.
Yeah, so you can, like, scratch it, or it really isn't a requirement for signature.
Sign includes any symbol executed or adapted by a person with a present intention to authenticate a writing. So basically you can do a rubber stamp or a fingerprint, X marks a spot, it all counts.
Right.
Proxy signature. One has proxy signed to the testator. but in the test series presence and under his direction control.
Nice.
The tester does not have to be physically or educationally unable to sign. And the proxy does not need to sign his own name, but it's a good idea to do it. It protects against forgery.
Forgery claims.
So, must be at the direction of tester examples. Here, let me sign that for you. No. Do you want me to sign it for you? Yes, it counts. Let me guide your hand borderline.
So, here, let me sign that for you doesn't work, right?
Is the proxy saying that?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
That's not... That's kind of funny. And then let me guide your hand is borderline.
Okay. Where on the will is a tester have to sign? I don't care what some states require. Texas allows tester to sign anywhere on the will. And where?
So you could... I think he said you could sign on the side or in the middle...
Okay.
That's kind of funky, but better to sign it.
Yeah. Okay. But it's better to sign at the end of the will to clarify testamentary intent, blah, blah, blah. Okay. And what does it require? When is it advisable to have more in case? Where a witness dies. Oh, yeah, to prove up the will.
Or you could have a self-proving affidavit.
True that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Or if you die in another state, the state's requirements are different. Okay. Substantial compliance rule is not the law in Texas, so why do we care?
Yeah.
I don't. Okay, publication.
No publication requirement.
No publication requirement in Texas. Publication is where the testator...
But it might be a good idea.
This is a will. Why is it a good idea? You move to a different state that requires it. It helps to establish testament capacity. Supports testament on the intent.
Nice.
Okay. Publication of will.
Why the witness on the testament?
You have to put flashcard. He declares that this is a will. Not required. Okay. What are the witnesses attesting to? Does the testator sign the document? That's a valid signature, and they authenticate the signature. So it's all about the signature. Subscription means signing at the end. Witnesses do not have to sign at the bottom. They can sign anywhere on the document as well. Okay. What if a witness attests before the testator signs? This is a contemporaneous transaction rule. It's not a problem. As long as the witnesses and testator sign as part of a contemporaneous transaction.
Nice.
Okay, I'm going to make a slide for that. Transaction rule?
Yeah. Contemporaneous transaction rule. What if the witness attests before testator signs? Not a problem.
As long as witnesses and testators
sign as part of a contemporaneous transaction, it is okay for the witness to sign before testator. So as long as witnesses and testators sign as part of a contemporaneous transaction, it is okay for the witnesses to sign before testator.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Nice.
What did witnesses sign up for testator 2 years later? Witnesses have a reasonable period of time after the testator signs to also subscribe their name. Court ruled that 2 years is okay, reasonable under the circumstances. What the hell are those circumstances? Okay. Witnesses don't actually have to see.
I know, right?
The testator signed the will? Okay, that's good to know.
But T has to see them sign the will. Yeah.
Okay.
What was that class that he, like, walked outside of the room, right?
That was where he was talking about having I believe it was for the proxy signature.
Okay.
Because it has to be under the testator's
direction.
Presence and direction. And his presence is basically, like, either, like, it's right there and you can see it, or just, like, a very subtle movement and you can see it. But it's, like, not, like, 14 feet away or something.
Nice.
I can't remember the exact verbiage of that rule, but it was like something like that.
Yeah, yeah. Witnesses don't actually have to sign the rule. Two witnesses do not have to sign in each other's presence. Other points, witness can't sign after
he dies. Would not be in the testator's presence. Witness cannot sign by a mark, must sign by their own names. Witness cannot use a proxy to sign, must sign in his own handwriting. Attestation clause.
What does that mean? Because T has bought the farm? Is that like a saying? Is that like playing house or something?
No idea.
Okay, fair enough.
Attestation clause, good practice to reinforce the witness's attestation of the will. Yeah, I think the attestation clause like goes at the end. It's saying, I hereby solemnly attest and swear, blah, blah, blah. Like, it's just a little clause.
There's an example right here. Foregoing instrument consisting of this and the number of preceding pages was signed, published, declared by client to be his or her last will. We now, at his or her request and his or her presence, subscribe our names in blue ink. That's interesting. That's funny. Okay. As long as as witnesses this day, day of the month, for identification, we have each initialed the page numbers preceding. Okay. So that's for attestation clauses, witnesses.
Just trying to figure out how I can remember the witness has to sign the testator's presence, but the testator does not have to sign the witness's presence. Seem to remember that. Conscious presence. Testator can see witness sign from his actual position, or can see the signing with a slight alteration that the testator can make without assistance. Slight alteration must be unaided. We have to remember that. Use presence, conscious, presence, test. Testator can see what this is actual position. They can see the signing with a slight alteration. Here's an overdrive up there.
My computer's like on overdrive. Yeah, I have a bunch of stuff open.
That the testator can make without assistance. Slight alteration without assistance. That's what we need to remember. I'm going to make that in caps. Slight alteration without assistance. Okay, drawing lines alteration for the challenge.
So T can see W sign from his actual position, or can see the signing with a slight alteration. So that's where he was like, over here, and then you kind of, he's like, well, what if I'm under the table? Okay, yeah. So this is what he was trying to say. The testator seeing the witnesses. Okay.
Yeah. Okay, purging statute. Witness as beneficiary. The beneficiary under a will is also a witness under the will, or is also a witness to the will. The gift may be purged under certain circumstances. Why? The beneficiary may be tempted to lie about sound mind, capacity, property executed, common law, who cares?
Well,
purging statutes makes the witness credible by taking away what they would have taken. The will cannot be proven otherwise. The purge occurs and the individual is not an interested party. Exceptions to the statute. If the witness would be an heir if the testator had already died intestate, in which case the witness may receive the gift provided it does not exceed the share of the testator's estate the witness could have taken under intestate succession. Okay, so basically, like, let's say that my daughter is her witness to my will, and I give her 100% of my estate. Under the purging statute, I believe that she would only take her intestacy.
If she was a witness.
If she were a witness.
Not to exceed intestacy amount.
Yeah.
Okay. So up to, yeah, okay.
Mm-hmm.
Could be less than the intestacy amount.
Yeah, and there's like a funky provision too, where it's like if you would receive more, yeah, because if you would receive more under intestacy, I think you still receive what you're supposed to receive under the will. If the will can be otherwise established, such as by the testimony of another witness. I'm going to flash out this.
Exceptions to the statute. If the will would be an heir. If the witness would be an heir.
Okay, so exception. If the witness
would be an heir if the testator had actually died intestate,
in which case
the witness may receive the gift provided it does not exceed the share of the testator's estate. The witness could take under intestate succession.
Okay. And then another exception is the will can be otherwise established.
Mm-hmm. The will can otherwise be established, such as by the testimony of another witness. Okay, yeah. So basically, if you would have been an heir, so that basically means if you're related to testator, right? If you're an heir by intestacy, that means...
Yeah, so like either you're somehow related...
Or you're the wife or spouse.
But then you would only basically receive your share under intestacy.
Right.
Or if the will can be otherwise established, that's probably what a lot of people would do in that situation, be like, okay, well, please go to probate court and, like, just establish this kind of testimony of another witness. If the testimony of the witness beneficiary is corroborated by a disinterested and credible witness, isn't that kind of the same thing as otherwise established? If the testimony...
Yeah.
...of the witness... beneficiary. Haven't you people heard of conflict of interest? Is corroborated by disinterested. Isn't this so interesting, Charles?
Yeah, I mean, it's just things. I guess I'm thinking about it like
Think about how much you know now.
Yeah.
About wills. I mean,
I'm thinking about like if I were drafting a will, what I would do, you know what I mean? Make sure I have at least two witnesses.
Totally.
Maybe have three, you know, if you're moving to another state. Yeah, I mean, it's definitely practical stuff.
It is.
Yeah.
Oh, purging statute hypos, long email. Woohoo!
Holy moly.
Are you going to be here late today, or are you thinking about leaving early?
I mean, I don't know. I was hoping we could get at least halfway. How many? So we're on page 30, end of 31.
Doing pretty well.
76. So what's half of 76? So like 36, yeah. No, 33. Yeah.
33.
Yeah.
Yeah. Wait, no, that's 66.
Oh, yeah, it is. 43?
This is while we're in law school and not engineering school. What are we trying to do? 76 divided by 2?
Yeah.
Let me see here.
It's an even number. 30.
I take it we're not mathematicians. 38.
Yeah.
We can do that. I mean.
You want to go up to 38?
And honestly, Espinito. Like, that's still only half of all the material that we need to go through. So I think that should be our bare minimum.
Yeah. Do you want to skip these purging statutes?
Or do Maybe we can do a few.
Okay.
Okay. When a widow dies survived by three children, L, M, and C, Lynn leaves 50% of her estate to L and 25% of her estate to Mo and 25% to Curly. Okay, 50% to Larry, 25% to Mo, 25% to Curly. Assume that Larry is a necessary witness to the will. How should Lynn's estate be distributed? Okay, so under the will, Larry would take 50%, but if he were to take intestate, he would take 33%. And, okay, so then Larry would just take 33%, and one-third of that would get left out, which is referred to as a partial lapse. So that's what you would say on the exam. And it partially lapses.
So he'd get 25%?
33%. Instead of 50. Okay, but let's assume that Curly is a necessary witness.
Okay, yeah.
He would get 25% of the will. Then under intestacy, he would get 33%. So under this rule, he would still only get 25%.
Nice. Okay, that makes sense, yeah.
Yeah.
Alrighty.
Okay.
Terry dies, survived by her two best friends, Rhonda and Esther.
Mm-hmm.
Terry's will leaves 75% of her estate to Rhonda and 25% to Esther.
Many testing witnesses are Rhonda and Paul. Carla, Terry's attorney, supervisor. Carla, the attorney, supervised the will execution ceremony. May Carla's testimony be used to save Rhonda's gift? I would say yes. Corroborated by a disinterested and credible person. Okay. That's the exception. Can save the witness beneficiary share. Okay. And I've heard that for his final, he takes directly from the hypos that he gives to us. So it's really good to get for all of them.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. May Paul's testimony be used to save Wanda's gift? Austin says yes. I'm lost on what this is asking. Maybe Paul is testing if you can save Wanda's gift. Who's Paul again? Oh, one of the witnesses? Who's also the best friend? But Wanda's. Yeah, Wanda's receiving. Wait, Paul. I'm getting so confused.
Paul was one of the witnesses.
A witness, but not a beneficiary, mm-hmm. right? Okay, so Alton says yes, can we otherwise establish, yeah, we can establish the will if one of the other witnesses is disinterested and credible.
Okay, all right, that makes sense. Like, that one disinterested witness can prove up the other one. Yeah.
Okay. Okay, I assume that Lon and Esther were the attesting witnesses. May Carla's testimony be used to save any of the gifts? What if Carla is dead? May any of the gifts be saved? Carla, the attorney's testimony, can be used to save the devices to both of the interested witnesses because Carla is a disinterested and credible witness.
Mm-hmm.
If Carla is dead, the gifts can be saved if there is some other disinterested and credible witness that can corroborate the interested subscribing witness's testimony. Okay. If there's no other person, the beneficiary is going to be SOL. Extra high goes from Alton. Suppose that T's will leave a legacy or device to X, who is the wife of Y. Y and another person, A, are the two subscribing witnesses to the will. Does this will apply here? What's the name of the William Purging Statute? No. Recent Texas cases have construed this section narrowly, holding the gift under the will to a spouse of a subscribing witness does not make that witness an interested person. Okay. Same facts. Will devised to X, who is married to Y, except that X and Y are the only two subscribing witnesses. What result? X takes to give because Y is not an interested witness.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And he can testify to prove the will. Okay, cool.
Nice.
Okay, I don't care if Texas should adopt the PC or not.
The executor is permitted to be
one. The executor is permitted to be one of the witnesses.
Because the executor is going to, I guess, be dead, right?
No, an executor is someone who is in charge of the estate.
Oh, okay.
And sometimes also okay. be a beneficiary. That's kind of weird. The executor is not an interested witness for the statute. Okay, so the statute leaves out an executor. So even if the executor is also a beneficiary, executors don't count. Okay, self-proving affidavit attestation clauses. What's the difference? Okay. Witness could sign a will without an attestation clause or self-proving affidavit, and it would still be valid. Self-proving affidavit is able to be used to prove up the will in court. I'm just going to say used to prove up the will in court. Document is sworn to. It's an affidavit. It dispenses the need to call one or both witnesses.
Yes, attestation. Okay, so self-proving affidavit, you're good to go in court. Attestation clause, you're still going to need to bring the witnesses to court. So I say do both, right? I mean,
yeah.
Yeah.
Why not? Attest that the individuals are signing as witnesses.
Yeah.
Does not sense of the need to call a witness. Okay, self-proving affidavit in particular.
Does not have to be.
There's no particular form for it. She has the option of making a will self-proved by either adding the affidavit as a separate document or including the affidavit within the text of the will. Okay, and put that in there too. Maybe a separate document or included in the text of the will.
Oh man, I feel like I could do a will right now. Don't you? I mean, I feel Am like, I? Yeah, to some degree.
I feel like I know the basics.
Yeah, yeah.
At least been tested to see which isn't real.
Yeah. Jeez.
Okay, so let's see here. Almost all wills contain them. Substitutes for in-court testimony by the witnesses. Okay. What has to be proved up to admit a will into probate? Self-proved will. No additional proof is needed to prove up the will. Non-self-proof will. Proof by sworn testimony or affidavit of one or more of the subscribing witnesses. Produce a witness or affidavit of witnesses or prove to the court why you can't produce a will. Blah, 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 blah. You know what I'm wondering is with the self-proving affidavit, like, okay. Let's say that you have a will, and then you have the self-proving affidavit.
Right.
That's a separate document, right? So, does the testator have to sign the will and have both witnesses attest to it?
Oh, you know what?
In both documents?
I think How does that work? I think that if the testator only signs the self-proving affidavit,
it's valid.
That only goes to the will and not the self-proving affidavit.
See, I know there's some kind of weird thing about that. Can we ask Alston about that tomorrow?
Yeah, let's. All right, I'll write it down.
Because I know there's like a trick with that. And I might have it in my meeting with him. Let me see.
Do you want to email him or?
No, I want to look at my notes when I'm meeting with him.
Okay. My theory is right now that it will only go to the will. Like, you won't have a signature for self-proving affidavit.
I want to know exactly.
But we want to know exactly, yeah. It's better to know than to guess, so.
Oh, for sure. So you put that in your notes to ask him?
Yeah.
Okay, when are you planning on meeting with him tomorrow?
I'm going to be here probably before he gets here. I wrote where when he's going to be here. Let me tell you.
Do you want to go through the rest of this outline tomorrow?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, definitely, if you want to. So he's going to be here.
I think we definitely should.
I believe Sunday afternoon from 3:30 to 6:30.
Okay.
And you know what I say? Let's just go there at 3:30, take as much time as we want and need, and then, because I sincerely think if a couple of us go, like, I'm going to try to get Kayla to go. If we're all in there, he treats it. He told me if there's multiple people in here, it's like I'm giving you 30 minutes, you 30 minutes, but I'm doing it all at the same time. So it makes him feel better, like he's helping more students.
Yeah, I mean, he'll take his time if there's two people in there and not three. I mean, it'll be fine. Whether Kayla's there or not. I mean, she's walking the path
of that. Oh, yeah, so, yeah, I know.
I think it'll be fine. He'll be happy to help.
And I asked Ryan if he wanted to come. I don't know if you know Ryan. Ryan Palmer.
Oh, Palmer. Yeah, I do.
Yeah, he told me on your birthday, he wrote, like, I devised you a cake.
Yeah.
But it's about to edeem.
Yeah.
Yeah. So now we know what edeem means, that the gift has disappeared. Been.
We talked about edemption.
It's extinct. Yeah, it's edemption by extinction. No, we haven't talked about it yet. But I remember, just remember, like, if he eats the cake, it's gone, right?
Yeah.
So, I guess you'll get the money's worth of the cake or something. Oh, no, wait. No, it'll be testator's intent that he didn't want you to get it.
Okay.
We'll get to that.
Okay.
Yeah. Sounds but that that can be like the hypo that you can, I devised you a cake, but it's a deed. Yeah. Okay.
More is required to be sworn to in a self-proving affidavit in a valid will in Texas. Oh.
Publication plus notary. And you don't need to notarize a will, but a notary can be a...
Do you not need to notarize a will?
Not in Texas.
Okay, so just signature...
But it can be a it can be a witness.
Signature plus two witnesses. Okay. Self-proving affidavit must be can be executed at the time of the execution or at a later date during the lifetime of the test hearing. Witnesses. Should I make that into a note card? Probably not. Would the invalidity of the self-proving affidavit invalidate the entire will? No. Self-proving affidavit is not part of the actual will. It does not invalidate the will itself. Simply is self-proven. So. Okay, I think this answers our question. A signature on a self-proving affidavit is considered a signature to the will if necessary to prove that the will was signed by the testator or witnesses or both.
Right.
But in that case, the will may not be considered a self-proved will. Signature cannot do double duty. I don't know about that.
Where are you actually?
Under witnesses only signed in Form B1.
Okay, yeah. current Texas law rule, signature on a... Oh, okay. That's what I was telling you. Like, if you only have the signature of the self-proving affidavit, it becomes a signature of the will.
By testator, witness, or both.
Right.
Okay.
So it can't be double duty.
So it can supplement, right, for the signature on a will by the testator.
Yeah, but then you won't have the self-proving affidavit. Yeah.
Gotcha. Okay, that's really good to know. Very important stuff.
One step or two step process. Now, it may be simultaneously executed, attested, and self-approved. Nice. Maybe one step, as in it's allowed to be.
Okay. I don't care what Alton would adopt. He's not a legislator. Okay, why are there two provisions for self-approving affidavits? One step and two step.
Holographical.
I don't care about selection witnesses or execution ceremony. Codicil supplement.
Yeah, codicil is important. Yeah. All right, holographic.
Codicil. Here, let me see. Codicil. The others. Codicil document. Document executed by a person who previously made his or her will to modify the requalifier of the provisions contained in it. Holographical requirements. Holy and testator's handwriting has to be signed by the testator. No need for self-proving affidavit. No witnesses required for holographic wills. That's kind of the biggest deal. So really pretty easy. In testator's handwriting, signed by the testator, no witnesses required. No self-proving affidavit required. Sound good?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's definitely. Holographic will.
Yeah?
No. Death, yeah.
Yeah? Okay. Not all jurisdictions recognize holographic wills. Texas does. Advantages to recognizing them. Cheaper. Can be done fast. I agree. It's in favor of rules in general. I don't really care too much about the disadvantages. And of course, it's probably easier to challenge. Okay. Okay. No dates are required on there. That's important.
Nice.
Holographic wills and holographic wills are equal strength. Either may revoke the other, and either may act as a codicil to the other. Surplusage rule?
Mm-hmm.
A testamentary instrument intended by the testator as a holographic will should be given effect, although its words not in the handwriting of the testator.
Oh, this was the case where, like, you have the... You write it, like, on a hotel stationery.
Yeah.
So... I don't think it matters in that case.
Those words... Okay, so the words that are not in the handwriting of the testator should not be given effect if those words are not necessary to complete the instrument in holographic form and do not affect its meaning. Okay. A court can completely ignore pre-printed words and it does not affect the meaning or the elements of the rule. The court can simply ignore them and admit the rule as a holographic will. Yeah, hypo written on a green card. You can ignore the pre-printed terms on the card.
Right.
Okay, I'm going to make a slide for that.
Nice. I think that's kind of straightforward. You got the surplusage rule. It's good. It's good stuff, yeah. It's always good.
Surplusage rule. Oops, I got it in there. A holographic will can help probate if the words are not in the handwriting of the testator. Are not necessary to complete the instrument in holographic form. The words in the testator. I'm just going to put do not affect its meaning. I think that's good enough. Okay. Alright. So here's a hypo. To PP, all my personal property to A in handwriting, and then all my real property to B typed. This probably can't be admitted under the surplusage rule because the type content definitely changes the meaning of the will. Okay. All my personal property and handwriting would be in the school probate. What happens to the will property? Partial intestacy. Sound good?
Mm-hmm.
Holographic will with signatures of two witnesses. We still admit it as a holographic will. The witness signatures do not change the meaning.
That's funny.
Really good to know. To be like, yeah, under the surplusage rule, the witness signature does not affect the meaning of the will. Probably get extra points for that.
Nice.
Husband and wife make a joint will.
Oh, he says don't.
Husband writes it, and wife signs it. Husband's part would be admissible, and wife's signature is surplusage. What a hot mess.
Yeah.
That's hilarious. I'm highlighting that.
It's all on the husband's handwriting.
You guys are retarded. Okay, what constitutes a signature? We already know it's super liberal. Oh, it also does not matter where on the holographic will it's signed. So that applies to both holographic and non-holographic.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Most holographic rules are homemade. Don't care. Military testaments. We don't even know about that.
We
already said he wouldn't test on it.
Types of gifts, device is real property bequest is.
Oh, he's on his.
Yeah,
he's on there.
Because that stuff doesn't exist anymore.
Yeah. Specific, general, demonstrative. He said he would not test this on demonstrative.
Right.
In that email.
That was a good email.
Twice. I think I'm good to stop here. What about you?
General legacy gift. We go up to 40.
Okay.
Redemption.
I'm just going to use restroom here. Right.
Alrighty, that sounds good.
Take a break.
Yeah, I'm going to stand up and stretch.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. I'll go see if I can bother someone.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think we'll have a profitable session with him tomorrow.
Yeah. Excuse me. I'm going to check on you real fast. I'm going to check my registry.
For, like, classes?
No, not writing registry.
Oh.
To see if anyone got me stuff.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
What is a registry?
A wedding registry?
Yeah.
It's where... No, just a second. It's where you register for everything that you want as a wedding gift.
Nice.
All of your wedding guests, as long as, like, basically the rule is, like, even the people you invite who don't come to your wedding, they're kind of supposed to buy your wedding gifts.
Nice.
Because you extended the registry invitation. But, yeah, no, we've gotten a lot of cool stuff already.
That's a smart way to do it, because sometimes you could get things that you don't really want.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you get all stuff that you want. I love it.
Is it okay to bring, like, because this is what I've done with friends. I just give them money.
Yeah, no, you can do that.
Okay.
Too. Yeah.
That's what makes it easier.
Yeah, and I've had people buy me stuff that's not on a register too, but.
That's alright.
Yeah.
I suppose. Maybe, I don't know.
Stuff it counts, always.
Yeah, yeah. That's a good mindset.
And then it's ended up too. All right. Are we working on where are we?
Actually, let me drop a class real quick.
Okay. What class
I was going to take courthouse perspectives.
Yeah.
In the winter term.
That sounds miserable.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't think I really want to do it. It was just kind of a placeholder in case of. No, I mean, it'd be interesting. I don't know. It's kind of like.
No, I just think it's doing anything in the winter. It's miserable.
Yeah. Well.
The winter break.
I wonder if this is kind of be like, Professor Blackwell's class. You know what I mean? Everyone's really scared and then the final's not that bad.
Yeah, well, I wouldn't be scared because it motivates me.
Yeah. Which website did you use for your, registry?
William Snow, Bed Bath & Beyond, and Anthropology.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
I like Anthropology.
I love Anthropology.
Wait, is it only a girl store, or? Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah. It's kind of...
No, they've expanded a lot, too.
Okay. That'll make me feel better. Drop that class. It was only one credit, so I think I might drop secure transactions to payment systems.
Okay, I have a question for you.
Okay.
Which set do you like the most between these three?
I definitely like that it's white and blue.
Yeah.
That's cool. I don't know, what are you going for?
Right now I'm registered for this set, mm-hmm. but I'm still...
It's kind of casual.
I think this is my least favorite. I just don't like that play. I think it's too much.
That is quite a bit.
Yeah.
So you're kind of thinking between these two over here?
I think so.
I like the circles. I don't know. It's kind of, they're definitely casual, right?
I mean, they're kind of expensive. They're like $90 for a four-piece set. And they're supposed to be kind of like, they're porcelain.
That's nice, yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. I think they're casual.
I shouldn't have said that. I feel bad. I feel bad.
No, I'm glad to hear that.
Well, I mean, they're cool to have,
right? This is what... So I had this like whole set on Anthropology, but then they put the plates on back order until March. But I love them. Let's see. Plates goals. What am I missing here? It's this set. I love this set. Does that look fancier to you?
Yeah, that's really classy.
I know.
I like it.
They put, so these plates they put on
that's classy.
Backwater. Yeah, kind of makes me angry.
Maybe
so they're not on backwater anymore. Let me see. So you definitely like this better, huh?
I would say so. Okay. But don't.
I do too. I do too.
Yeah, those are pretty cool. They seem, were those cheaper?
I don't know if they're cheaper, because no, I think they're a little bit more expensive.
Is it 24 per? Like,
yeah.
Oh, okay. Play. Yeah, I guess it depends how much you get it.
A little pricey. That's good to hear, though. You know, you're right, because the other one does look a lot more casual.
Yeah.
That's a good point.
Which isn't bad, right?
No, that's a good point. So I want for it to be more flexible. They took me off of that quarter. Okay, we're back in business.
Let's do it.
Okay, sweet. Okay, I just need to update my registries real fast.
Sounds good. Still need to decide for like a 2-credit class to take next semester. I might take animal law with you.
Do it.
I don't know. It's just.
How could you not know if you want to take animal law?
It sounds
really?
Cool. No, it really sounds cool. Do you? Who's teaching it?
I have no idea.
Oh. Okay, so you're being a little.
I just want to
you're
take
being
animal
brave.
Law.
That's very brave of you.
I can't. I know that I would always regret not taking that class. It just sounds too cool.
Are you part of the Animal Legal Defense Fund Club? I am. I think I'm like the only member in the school.
And you haven't found a family yet, because?
Well, I mean, I don't know. I kind of want to take bar classes.
No trials.
Okay, I'll think about it.
Let's see who the teacher is. Can you find out?
Yeah, I'm looking for the schedule right now. So spring 2016. Let's see.
Excuse me.
Animal. So it's Fear Dawn. I'm looking at a person online.
Who that?
Dawn Fear. F-E-A-R-E. Oh, this guy's big time animal law. Receives Lifetime Achievement Award.
Whoa.
For animal law. So this is, if you're going to take animal law, from the animal law section of the State Bar of Texas.
Wow.
Wow. So if you're going to take it with anyone.
That's awesome.
You got to take it with, damn. Dang.
Turn that down.
Yeah, that's.
Dang. Yeah, I'm so excited to take it.
Oh, wow. So he was recognized as the city of Arlington for his role in the largest animal cruelty seizure in world history. So he saved 27,000 animals.
Wow.
Nice.
That's awesome.
Hmm.
I don't know.
This dude's where it's at. Dawn Fear or Fairy. That's pretty cool.
What?
That he's a cool guy.
It's not for the badass.
Yeah, definitely.
Excuse me. You left the street. Is it working? Okay, awesome. I got the one that I wanted again because they don't want to start. Thank you to you for your opinion. You're nice. So right. The other one was good. It looks so much more casual. Thanks, Charles. Don't know what I've been
always
doing.
Got your back. Yeah. There's a lot of classes coming in. I kind of wanted to do one of the clinics, but...
Yeah, I think they're awesome.
Have you done them?
Mm-hmm. I did lock on it.
Have you taken family law?
Yes.
It's for what? Is First Amendment just like a normal class?
What do you mean by normal?
It's just, like, is it a seminar, or?
I think it's just a regular 3-hour course with Rambo.
Nice.
Sounds awesome.
That does sound pretty cool.
I mean, it'll be great.
There's so many classes that are cool in law school. It's kind of,
yeah.
It's really interesting.
What are the classes you're taking now?
So I'm taking payment systems, preparing for the bar, mm-hmm. Cayman Islands, and state and local trade barriers, and I'm trying to fill in one law. Do you want to try to hit a little bit more?
Yeah. Sorry, I just got
it. Yeah, me too. No, it's the same here. Okay. I'm on page 37, Redemption. Are you there, Lord?
Let's see. Redemption.
When the testator makes a specific request in a will before the testator dies, that specific item is no longer in the testator's, I guess, possession. Extinction of a specific bequest or device because of the disappearance of or disposition of the subject matter given from the estate of the testator in his lifetime only applies to specific gifts. So not like money, I guess. So like this is like I give you my pre-Columbian vase, right?
Yeah.
That was a. So if testator leaves specific gifts and they have been voluntary.
Voluntarily?
Yeah, let's change that. Disposed.
Disposed of during testator's life.
Mm-hmm.
In the rule of silent, the beneficiary takes nothing.
Yes. So that means testator probably intended for me not to get it. So I sold the pre-Columbian vase. Yeah.
Yeah, that's probably what the presumption is.
Okay.
Just and being a jerk. Or just ran out of money. Like, sorry.
Default rule, not a rule of law, can be drafted around. Okay, cool. I leave you the Volvo wagon, and at the time of my death, I have sold the Volvo wagon, and I own Honda Civic. Then you take nothing. Okay.
Oh, okay.
If the person made a will, the court will construe it in a way where all the property passes through will instead of construing where any part passes through intestacy. Person made a will, the court will construe it. If a person made a will.
It's basically no silence.
Yeah. The presumption is when someone makes a will, they intend to pass everything. So, I don't know what he's talking about.
I'm just going
to
delete that.
Yeah.
It's probably what's highlighted, because it makes some sense. Exceptions to redemption can classify the gift as non-specific. Oh, so what if you say, I leave my pre-Columbian vase to you. This is a non-specific gift.
What?
Well, is that what it means? Classify gift as non-specific?
That's interesting. I don't know if that... We need to ask him that.
Yeah, because it's... Tell him that the exception to redemption is if you classify the gift as non-specific. What does that mean? Because that's honestly what it sounds like.
No, well, actually, I'm kind of skeptical. Like, how could you classify a specific gift?
You would expressly state, "This is I classify this gift as a non-specific gift." I mean, I doubt that's the case, but...
We'll ask him tomorrow.
Okay. Addendum does not apply if the item is changed in part only. What the heck does that mean?
Very rare exception. Left real property, but the real property was sold. So, if you sell something, then it's only a change in form, a change in substance, not in form. So, changing it into money is not a change in form. Okay. All right. All right, let's ask him about that.
So, like, I leave my pre-Columbian pottery vase to Claire, and then I sell it, and I get $5,000 for it. The $5,000 is hers.
I don't think so, because that says it's only a change in substance. Oh, wait, no, yeah. Yeah, she would get the $5,000. Okay.
Wait, addendum does not apply if the item has changed in form only. Yeah.
Yeah, so she would get it, because it's only changed in substance.
So.
Yeah.
But it says it's a very rare exception. Why is it very rare?
What would be a redemption?
I would definitely ask him about that.
Okay.
Voluntary disposition of property, foreclosure, casualty, loss, condemnation, guardianship, and property caretaker. She died a week later, so you don't intend to part with property. Oh. So then the exception to exemption is involuntary disposition of the property, such as foreclosure, casualty, condemnation, guardianship, selling property to care. Just remember involuntary disposition of the property.
So, like, it burns down or something, right?
I think so. Exception to exemption. Because that would be a change in substance, right?
Mm-hmm.
But that's one of the exceptions.
So, draft it around.
Oh.
There's, like, a way. There's something in here that I shouldn't do. Appointment, trustee, employees of trust. Okay, that's nice. So draft it around. Okay, I guess there's just a way to draft around it. I'll ask him for a hypo drafting round. The general rule is that a specific legacy is deemed taken away if the thing is disposed of by testator during his lifetime. When a gift deems, the court will not allow it the intended beneficiary to receive the equivalent value via tracing or otherwise. Do you know what tracing means?
Yeah. So when a gift deems, the court will not allow the intended beneficiary to receive the equivalent value via tracing. So tracing just means like, you go through the bank records and you're like, okay, he bought it for $4,000.
Oh, okay.
But you could receive equivalent value via tracing and if the gift was sold for cash.
Yeah.
As far as I know. Unless the will provides otherwise. Remember equitable conversion. If my nephew is entitled to real property from my will and I have a contract to sell Blackacre and I'm leaving Blackacre to my nephew and sign a contract that haven't handed over the deed of conversion to his property has been obtained. Okay. That's cool.
You want a piece of gum?
No, thank you.
Okay.
Just remember under equitable conversion title, when it does apply, property has a deed.
Okay. Good. I like it.
Yeah. Makes you sound like you're really on top of it. Hypo. Trustee has a collection of valuable pre-Columbian pottery and will leave the pottery to A. The collection was destroyed in a fire. Oh, that's an exception because it's involuntary disposition.
Right.
But what's that called? Involuntary disposition of the property. So it was destroyed in a fire and testator collects insurance on a loss. A claims the proceeds from insurance. The residuary devisee says no. It was a specific device and the will was silent. Deemed to be an involuntary loss. Wait, Charles, I don't think I'm right. Because remember how I told you, like, oh, change in form only? Like, if you sell the pre-Columbian vases for $5,000.
Mm-hmm. To change in substance. So that means it has been.
I think it would have deemed.
Let's go to the next hypo. I'm pretty sure like one of these hypos will bring up that case where he sells the pre-Columbian goods.
Okay.
So the pottery collection was lost with devise.
Yeah, I understand if it's lost to the Danes. Sold it, but don't know where the proceeds are. So that makes me think that maybe it does count if you sell it. I feel like redemption is just if it just randomly disappears.
Wait, so for the first types of hypo, is that redemption?
Yes.
Involuntary?
No, it's an exception to redemption.
Okay, so that means you get the money worth?
Yeah. You can collect on the fire insurance.
You should ask Bridget to ask Mac some other outlines. Just throwing that out there.
We only need this one.
I just want an outline like this for every class.
Oh, I know.
Yeah.
I know, it's amazing, isn't it?
I mean, we're pretty much done. Yeah, so I guess it doesn't really matter.
Yeah. Now I see why it's a good idea to go on with you. So you can get a lot of people's outlines.
I bet not everyone has his outline, though. And more of you. Like, I'm pretty sure they're, like, friends, and that's how they...
Yeah. About that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Hypo, suppose she devises Black Acre B before her death. She sells Black Acre and takes the proceeds to buy White Acre. That would be a change in substance, right?
Yeah, I'd say so.
T dies without changing her will, but she still owns Whiteacre. B claims Whiteacre, but residuary beneficiary claims it as well. Adoption does not apply. It is specific. Change in form only? Nope. Not a change in form because property is unique. Adoption applies.
So it was a change in substance.
Can you add to your list just to make sure that, like, if we sell the pre-Columbian poverty basis for $5,000, mm-hmm. that the beneficiary would collect the $5,000 from the state?
Yeah. So if we sold it, it redeems, right?
Well, that's what I'm trying to figure out. Like, I know for sure that if you sell it and buy something else, I think it redeems. Like, buy something else in its place. So that's what we were just talking about with Black Acre and White Acre.
Right.
I don't know.
We'll ask him tomorrow. I just wrote it down. So this is what I wrote down. If we sold the pre-Columbian vase, does it redeem?
Yeah.
And then he'll probably have something to say. Yeah. Nice. Alrighty. I think it's good because we're talking out like the variations.
Yeah.
I mean, I think we're hitting every single type of variation.
I think so.
Yeah.
Okay, testator's will devises Black Acre B. The testator goes to the biggest hotshot attorney, and the attorney decides that Black Acre should be sold to a corporation that is wholly owned 100% by the testator. Testator dies not owning Black Acre, but owns 100% of the stock by the corporation that owns Black Acre. Change in form only? Doesn't a deem that be one instance where a fairly harsh court says that it is a change in form only? I mean, this is good to know. Texas courts have uniformly held that when a provision in the will devises an interest in real property and describes that property's physical location, the device is a deemed if the property matching that description is not present in the testator's estate upon its death. Would the following gifts be subject to adoption if the shares of XYZ Corporation stock were not in the testator's estate? I give 50 shares of XYZ stock to Q. I remember us going through these. An exception applies because it is a non non-specific.
Right.
It's non-specific. What is that then? Well, it's non-specific.
It's just, it's general, I think.
So it only applies to specific, but this is general. Okay. I give 50 shares of XYZ Corporation stock to Q. I give my 50
right.
shares.
So that makes it specific.
Okay.
Okay.
Weird.
And then you have a specific stock certificate.
This is breath.
Mm-hmm.
I give stock certificate blah blah blah, and there for a specific.
So if it deems, you don't get the money.
Right. You don't get anything.
Okay. How can you use your knowledge of the indenture rules to prepare for? Oh, okay. Nice.
Okay. If we don't know what happened to the property, then the default rule is redemption, right?
Mm-hmm.
We know that it is stolen, so we take the equivalent value from another source. Redemption still applies. The property wasn't insured, and there are no proceeds from that property. Okay. I mean, it basically, that's what it's meant to cover. It's like stolen property,
right,
to an extent. Okay, satisfaction. Sometimes called redemption by satisfaction.
Right, so that's like the advancement form.
Yeah.
So an inter vivos gift.
Oh, excuse me. Satisfaction is a principle which denies a legatee under a will the right to receive the legacy if the testator, after executing the will, has made an inter vivos gift of the legacy to the legatee with the intention that the gift shall constitute satisfaction. So basically, testator makes a gift during his lifetime with the intention for that gift to be a replacement for the quest, the device.
Right. So I guess it just counts against it.
Yeah.
So you use the hodgepodge rule.
Very similar to advancement in the intestacy context. Applies to specific general or demonstrative gifts. Common law. Don't care.
Or hodgepodge.
Okay, statute. For a lifetime gift to be considered satisfaction, T must declare in a contemporaneous writing, devisee acknowledges in writing. I think it's for devisee acknowledges in writing. It does not have to be contemporaneous. Okay, so an advancement. The decedent can declare contemporaneously or prior to giving a gift.
Right. But not after.
But not after. Whereas in satisfaction, the testator must declare contemporaneously. But not prior.
Where do you see that?
It says here, for a lifetime gift to be considered satisfaction, T declares in a contemporaneous writing. It doesn't say or prior writing.
All right, let's ask him.
Oh, excuse me. Tired.
Yeah.
I'm getting burned out.
You want to get up to page 40?
Sure.
Okay. interest presumption, exoneration of liens. So I think that Texas doesn't have the rule for exoneration of liens. And
you can never do that where you like. How do people do that? I always got cars on me.
Oh, that's funny.
Okay, sorry. I'm getting tired.
Yeah. No, it's all
easily
good.
Easily distracted. Okay, exoneration of liens.
The exoneration of liens, I think you basically have to draft around it.
Okay. Statute, a specific gift passes subject to each debt secured by the property that exists on the date of the trustee's death.
So this is how I think the hypo works out. I two children, right? T gives to A $10,000, and
yeah.
T gives to B a house, right?
Okay.
If you draft around exoneration, meaning that there can be exoneration, then that $10,000 has to be used to pay off the lien. So basically, one child gets nothing, and the other one gets everything.
Well, can't just be that vague. I mean, does it say that you have to use funds in the estate to pay?
Yeah, I think so. I actually have this question written down, exoneration of liens.
Okay.
We'll ask him.
It says, T may expressly provide the will for debts against a specific gift to be exonerated.
Okay.
Okay, that's what I would remember. That's probably the main takeaway. So I'll put that in here.
What are you putting in there?
T may expressly provide the will for debts against a specific gift to be exonerated.
Okay, yeah.
And it has to be a specific gift.
Changes in values of
T's property.
Yeah.
You need to be clear if you want individuals to take individual shares, plan for appreciation, depreciation. If the will is silent, the default rule supply. What is the default rule? Measured at time of gift?
Yeah.
Or the time of testator's death.
Let me.
I would think of the time of death. But maybe not.
Oh, wow, that's great. It's like not even a page.
What do you mean?
Okay. I don't think it really matters, but I'll ask him. Does that sound good?
No, I think it matters.
Okay.
I mean, I would just find, like, one is the property value for purposes of, you know, appreciation, depreciation. At the time of the will's making or at the time of testator's death.
Okay. Sounds good. Alrighty.
Okay.
Change in value of stuff.
Securities. The default rule is that maybe drafted around. Who cares? Okay, I would just remember that with securities that it does include stock splits. Wait, come on. Default rule would be like the securities are owned by the T on the date the rule is executed includes the following additional securities. It also includes stock splits, new issues acquisition. That's really all I think you need to know.
Here's my question. Let's just take a step back. So with stocks, if it's a specific stock, then you get the money's worth, right? No, wait, you don't.
You get the stock. Are you saying, I devise 50 shares in my stock of XYZ Corporation?
Yeah.
You would specifically get that stock over. But
what if it's already been sold? Like, it doesn't.
If it's already been sold?
You get the worth, right?
That would be a specific gift that's been converted. I don't think the redemption would apply because of what we talked about where you sell something.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that you would get the value of that property.
Okay.
So nice. Whatever you sold it for, I think.
But if it was general, then that's too bad. Like, I give you 50 shares. Not my
right.
50, yeah.
I mean, if it's general, then you would take the money from the estate to purchase the 50 shares for that person.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, right. So if it's specific, it's like, too bad, it's a deemed.
I don't think it would be a deemed.
Like, my 50 shares?
Because, I really think that what redemption applies to is if something just goes missing. Like, you know, I've got
right.
a really expensive Cartier pen, and then all of a sudden, you know, whenever I die, it can't be found. Oh, redemption, sorry. The gift is gone. But, if it were sold, this is what I think. I don't know if I'm right. But I think that if it were sold, then the beneficiary would get whatever it was sold for out of the estate funds.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I think. But just remember that, with stocks, let's say that I devise my 50 shares of XYZ Corp stock, and then those stocks split, or there's a merger, and the stocks, turn into stock for another company. That counts. Okay, there's some hypos here. Hypo, testator owned 100 shares of XYZ Corporation stock and left those shares to Willie and the rest of his estate to Ethel. Okay, prior to T's death, XYZ declared and paid a cash dividend of $1 per share. Upon T's death, he was entitled to the $100. So that goes to Ethel. Under the statute, a divide of securities does not include a cash distribution. I will remember that. Definitely, we need to remember the hypos, so I said we go through them again tomorrow. We don't
definitely.
Have to go through them together, but just
yeah,
read them.
Yeah.
Okay, other hypo. After T's death, XYZ declares and pays a cash dividend of $1 a share. Who is entitled to the 100 goes to Willie, gift vested in Willie upon T's death.
Okay.
So, dividend. Excuse me. Prior to T's death, XYZ merged with Acme. T then received 200 shares of Acme stock. I think that Willie would be entitled to that. Securities and other organizations result from merger. So, yeah. And then absent the statute, E's argument. He's just playing around to get you to think about it. Ethel's argument would be to claim redemption because the specific gift is now gone. And then Willie's argument would be that was a change in form only.
Right.
Yeah. Okay, cool, that makes sense. Abatement. Default rule can be drafted around applies only if the rule is silent. Oh yeah.
You need to memorize this series. So it's like intestacy. It's always personal real. And then residuary, general, specific.
Okay.
So, intestacy, residuary, general, specific.
Okay, I'll make a slide for it.
Yeah.
Abatement.
And then,
intestacy. Or, I'm sorry, abatement.
Yeah, abatement order. For paying, so abatement order is to pay off estate taxes.
Oh, it's used just for estate taxes? I thought it was used for, major debt.
Oh, yeah, and debts and other estate taxes, yeah.
Caught it in the end.
Okay.
Charles, something that I would like to do tomorrow is, I don't know what your schedule's like, so don't feel any pressure, but I would like to try and get up maybe around 11 or 12 to go over some more of this outline, because I want to be able to ask all sorts of any questions as possible.
Right,
and I
definitely.
Know so I was reviewing, I've reviewed most of that one myself, and I know that some of it gets kind of tricky.
Right.
Like, pretty tricky, like around the 50s marker.
Okay, yeah, we're at 41 or so.
40.
Yeah.
So, I mean, just let me know what your schedule is, but if you can do that, that would be awesome.
Yeah, yeah, I'll be here.
And then we can just kind of review flashcards later on in the day.
Right.
You know? Oh, man. Here no later than 12, realistically.
Okay, that sounds good. Yeah, I like sleeping in, so.
I do too.
Yeah, I think we've made some good progress.
Me too. Okay. Okay, so we got through redemption.
And we got a lot of questions to ask him tomorrow. Yeah.
Kent will.
This will probably take like
a couple hours.
Well, maybe not a couple, but definitely a good hour.
How many questions do you have there?
I mean, I'm just like writing terms and asking him, you know.
Like, can I see?
You can.
Read your handwriting, but let me try.
Sure, you can. Hey, tell me I have good handwriting. It's
well,
like the most beautiful.
Well, you're supposed to be an attorney. You're not supposed to have good handwriting.
Yeah. Oh, no, those are just the questions that page. The rest was like working out.
That's an exception. Publication. Ooh, you can't just ask about DRR.
Yeah, you can. Give us an example.
We're going to be there forever.
No, we won't. It'll be easy.
You have to ask him that last second, because you can't just ask him about DRR. Otherwise, we'll be there forever.
No, it'll be quick. You think, okay, we'll save DRR for later.
Oh, yeah, patent and late name ambiguity. I definitely want to listen to that. I had a hard time with that. That was one of the things I was struggling with the other day.
Oh, can you play audio?
Dependent relative revocation or implied.
Nice.
I was studying my online flashcards one day right before the final on my iPhone, and it kept playing them out loud, and I was getting so angry.
That's funny.
Yeah, it was embarrassing.
Okay, so this is good. We'll ask him a lot of questions tomorrow.
Can you tell me about everything in our class now, please?
No,
I'm just kidding.
If we bring a lot of people there, he won't care.
He'll be fine.
Yeah, we just, I'm going to try to, I can't believe Kale's going to a party. It's, she didn't, it's alright.
I mean, she couldn't really follow along without this outline.
Right. And I'm going to try to get Ryan in, but he doesn't like coming to school. So, but you and I will definitely get some good stuff done.
Yeah. I mean, really my goal is just to get through this outline and then just study the hell out of those flashcards, and I think I'll be in a really good place.
Yeah, definitely.
Okay. So here's a high note. Ken's rule contains the following explosive language. I leave my gold watch to X. Leave 10,000 to A, 5,000 to B. Remainder to C. Ken's estate has $20,000 in cash. Let's try to work this problem out with the answer.
Well, which one are we doing?
It's on the bottom of page 39 for me. So I've been amending my. It starts with. It's in a box. Ken's rule contains the following explosive language.
Hold up. Okay, yeah, I got it. Wow, you deleted it a little bit.
Right. What page is that on for you?
I haven't really deleted anything. What? 41.
Oh, 41.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm on 39.
Ken's will contains the following dispositive language. I leave my gold watch to X. Okay, Ken's estate. How should it be distributed? So first we go to the remainder, which is the residuary. Then we split up proportionally the general between these two guys.
Oh, yeah.
And then we go to the gold watch.
So, remainder first, personal property, general, real property, general. And specific is last. Okay, and if there's 12,500 worth of debts, meal expenses, etc., you try. Okay, so remainder first, there's not enough in there. We go to personal property from the general, and then the gold watch will be last.
Right.
Okay. The will assign, you have to work through the abatement order. We need to say that on the exam, too.
Right, because we always want to follow testator's
intent. Right. Okay, so C gets nothing. The residuary is first to go. A and B have general request of personal property. Oh, I like how... Okay, so we need to do that, too. We need to say... A and B have a general request for
right.
personal property.
Nice.
What does that mean? Only 7,500 for a separate thing, debt out of the 20,000 cash. Oh, okay. Oh, that's interesting. Only 7,500 exists. So
you take it out proportionally.
Proportionally to what they receive under the will?
Yeah, so like if you need 50, I guess if you need like $5,000, you wouldn't take all of A's. You'd kind of split up. Like maybe take half of it from, well.
Yeah, like how does that work? I hope he gives us a very similar example. Take proportionally. Proportionally to what?
I guess if you need like 1,000 from them, you would take out. Proportionate.
Like, what if only 2,000 was remaining? How would you? I guess because A is getting twice as much as B, you would give A.
So A would have to give twice as much as B is giving. Like, so for every 100 that A gives. No, for B gives 50.
Okay. All right. X has specific request of personal property.
Okay, we're going to ask him about the abatement order.
Just about how to divide that in that instance.
Okay. You write it down?
Yeah.
Cool. You didn't.
What, burned out?
Yeah, just...
I'm getting super burned out.
Yeah. But we got, like, so when did we start? Like, 2, 1?
Page 1.
I don't know, how, like, what time?
Oh, I didn't get here until at least 2.
Yeah, so and then we spent about an hour over there. So we went from 2 to 9. That's 7. We got about 6 hours to study.
Not as much as I would have wanted.
But we did cover a lot.
Really
and did, we did like over, I'd say at least half the course.
Yeah.
And then we have a lot of questions for
I just hope that we can get through all of this tomorrow. Because that's really my goal is to like, have reviewed all the material and then really start to try to commit it to memory because I need time to do that.
Right.
Yeah.
Do you feel good about intestacy?
I definitely do. And I mean, the final isn't until 6:30.
Oh, yeah, I'm going to study on Monday as well.
What time do you think you'll. I mean, how long?
I'm going to sleep in as much and then I'll just wake up.
And just roll.
Probably. Like a couple hours.
Just a couple of hours.
Yeah. Because you want to be well slept. Because it's late at night, you know, and that's when you're going to be crashing, so to speak.
I will probably study pretty hard for it from like 11 to 4 that day.
And then chill out for a little bit.
Yeah. Take like a couple of hours off and then just go.
Yeah.
5 hours to review should be good.
Yeah.
That's what I want to do, is just like review all the terms, like have it finished memory like that day. Like not go to sleep on it or anything, you know.
Alrighty.
I feel pretty good about it. I mean, so far.
Yeah, me too.
We'll get to harass Alton tomorrow.
Oh, dude, I'm looking forward to it.
Me too.
Looking forward to it. Here, let me give you this very nice sheet. And I think it's kind of pretty accurate. I mean, to some degrees.
It helps because it gives you a bigger picture.
Yeah.
That's just nice when you're looking at all the branches.
I'm going to, like, look over parts of this outline on my tablet before I go to sleep. So.
Okay. I'm not doing anything else tonight. Peace out here.
Nice.
I think I'm going to watch a movie.
Yeah. What movie are you going to watch? What movie are you going to watch?
I've really been wanting to watch Trainwreck.
Oh.
Have you seen that?
I heard it's kind of sad.
Sad?
I don't know what it's about.
It's like a comedy romance.
Oh, really? Mm-hmm. Oh, okay. Oh, never mind. Sounds pretty good.
Yeah.
I like comedies. I don't like dramas and things like that.
Oh, I love all of it.
Okay, so, yeah, you know what? I love tablets. You just sit down there, just kind of scroll through.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if you have a tablet.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you just sit down. And
yeah, they're good for reading.
Who reads? Nobody should ever read. I'm just kidding. That was a joke.
Kidding.
That was a joke.
You would be in law school if you really thought that.
Well, you never know.
You wouldn't. Can't imagine hating to read and being in law school. You did good today, Charles.
Yeah. so I can do the flashcards on my tablet. So. Mm-hmm.
It's super handy. I love that Quizlet app. But don't share it with anyone. I spent hours on those.
I won't.
You gotta keep the competitive edge, you know?
Yeah, definitely.
You can share them with people after the final. How about that?
Sounds like a deal.
Okay.
Yeah.
Document to be.
Okay. You know what? I might just let this play out while I'm driving.
That sounds miserable.
No, that's pretty cool.
How long of a drive do you have?
I don't know. I was thinking about going to Dallas today, but I might not.
Tonight?
Yeah, see family and stuff. I don't know.
Oh, that sounds nice.
Well, I don't know if I want to, though, because it's a bit of a drive. Like, if it was next door, I'd go, but because then I have to drive back. I don't really want to spend the night there. I want to do my facial mask. And...
Your facial mask.
Yeah. That sounds bad. I should say that. I love my family. It just takes a while to drive back. Dallas.
So this is so interesting. I just found out that on Facebook you can go to settings and ads, and then you find out what they think your interests are to generate ads for you. So like it's telling me like.
Let me see.
Like, or if you want. Yeah, no. Go right ahead. Like all of this stuff they think I'm interested in. How crazy, and then you can like delete stuff that's not that you don't like. Fast food? Nope. Horseback riding? I've never liked that. How funny.
Interesting.
Pull it in.
So you could
acting.
Just delete everything, right?
Yeah. Miniature pig for sure. I'm obsessed with miniature pigs.
Are you?
Yes.
Really?
Yes. I love mini pigs. But they're not really mini, they grow into full blown pigs. Did you know that? Oh my gosh. One of them says pig.
Oh my god.
That is so funny. Spirituality Law School.
Nice.
Singing? Well, you're actually pretty dead on. Islam? First person shooter games, are you joking me?
Miniature pigs.
It's so cute. Thank you.
I'm looking that up.
Have you never seen that?
Is that like a animal?
House.
Okay.
Precious house.
Oh my gosh, okay, I can see it. It's a little piggy.
It is just pure preciousness.
Mini pig. Oh, I kind of want to get one.
They're adorable, but they grow it. They don't stay mini.
Aww, cute little tiny guy. really small. Like, the size of your hand is smaller.
But I'll show you that one morning when you could. The animal that I want the most in this world. It's one of these.
Little kitty?
It's a Scottish Fold Munchkin mix. So the Munchkin cats are like these, like, they're like the cat version of a wiener dog. They're like really low and long.
Yeah.
And the Scottish Fold is like what I have with the folded ears. They're adorable. They don't even look like real cats. So cute. What? I really want one.
Interesting little guys. They're from Scotland or something?
Scottish Folds are. Yeah. They were first discovered in Scotland. It's actually... have you seen my cat before? I post about him all the time.
I think Caitlin or Bridget told me you had a weird cat.
Yeah. The ears are like a deformity.
I'm sorry.
No, they breed them that way.
Oh, okay.
See how the ears are folded?
Yeah.
Yeah. But it doesn't hurt them. It's just like a genetic mutation to their ears. That makes them look more owlish.
Okay.
Yeah, and they have bright personalities.
Nice.
Yeah, he's more like a dog than a cat.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
That's interesting.
See, he's super social. Just sweet. You know how some cats are like aloof and mean. He's not like that. Do you like Ambus?
Yeah. I used to have a ferret, and then I had another ferret. Do you know what ferrets are?
I do. Yeah. Along Came Polly.
Along Came Polly?
Have you ever seen that movie? It's with Jennifer Aniston. She has a pet ferret.
Oh, nice.
I'll show you.
Yeah, I love ferrets.
She's like a super quirky person. She's like very adventurous, and she has a pet ferret, if I can say it.
And then I used to have a koala. Do you know what those are?
No.
Yeah, so they're from South Texas. Yeah, she looks kind of quirky in there. Is that Ben Stiller?
Yeah.
Yeah, nice. Yeah, I love ferrets. The only problem is they smell like weird. You need to like clean them or... And we used to have a dog. We used to have a couple dogs. Dalmatian.
Oh, Dalmatians are cool. They're supposed to be mean, though.
No, she's fine. And, you know... We used to have chickens.
Chicken?
Yeah.
Little chickadee?
Yeah, little coop. And we ate the eggs, and then my dog ate the chickens. So.
Oh, no. Yeah.
That was pretty bad.
Oh, that is bad. Oh, man. I'm ready to get out of here.
Yeah, me too. I'm going to pack up.
Yeah, we'll be here for a long time tomorrow, so.
Yeah. Get some good sleep, relax.
Definitely.
We did a lot of the tests and some questions.
Yeah, we really did. Feel pretty good about it.
Definitely. I mean, family and stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah, so. I guess my grandma's old house is there too.
Yeah. And then how far are you looking from school?
I just live like off 30.
Yeah.
Like I live by the intersection of 30 and 820. It's like near the edge of Fort Worth. I guess a little bit before the Fort Worth border.
To Arlington?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. It's like before, do you know that? There's like a sign that says Fort Worth City.
Who are you living with your first year?
Tyler and Andreas.
You're not living with them anymore.
No. Tyler got married. And...
Yeah, oh yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Who does Andreas live with?
We just live alone now.
Okay.
Yeah. So, but we all live in the same complex. It's kind of weird.
Oh, that's
We're like neighbors.
Huh.
So, but it's all good. Yep.
All right.